This week, in Parshat Korach, we read about one of the great rebellions in Jewish history. Korach and his group of followers and fellow rebels mount a protest against the leadership of Moses and Aaron, and Moses makes a dramatic intervention. And I'm going to call this How Not to End a Rebellion. So let's begin at the beginning. Korach rebels. Korach and his followers rebel against Moses, and they challenge his leadership. We're all holy. Why do you lift yourself up above us? Why do you give yourself airs and graces? It's too much. Korach rebels. Korach, son of Kohat, the son of Levi, who was very envious that he wasn't made a Kohen. Then there were some people from the tribe of Reuven. Don't forget, Reuven was Jacob's firstborn son, so how come none of the Reubenites got positions of leadership? And there were 250 Israelite men from other tribes, well-known community leaders. How come nobody invited us? In other words, it was a typical Jewish broiges. Why weren't we invited? Why aren't we on the leadership team? And so on. And the question is, what happens next? And as you know, something rather dramatic happens. Moses prays that the ground opens up and swallows his followers alive. He says, if the Lord brings about something totally new, and the earth opens its mouth and swallows them with everything that belongs to them, and they go down alive into the realm of the dead, then you know, I'm the leader and not them. Now, I would call that a pretty reasonable way of ending a conflict. Would we not like all those people who are against us that the ground should open up and swallow them alive? You would have thought that's a pretty effective means of conflict resolution. Well, you would have thought, since what Moses prayed to happen happened and happened immediately, it would have ended the conflict. Right? What happens next? The next day, the whole Israelite community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. You've killed the Lord's people, they said. It didn't end the conflict. They are still complaining. And something very serious then happens. God sends a plague against the people. The plague has started, says Moses. Go and do something, says Aaron. And by the end, 14,700 people died from the plague. It did not end the conflict. Now, this is odd, because we know that if you have a really serious problem and you want a miracle to prove your point, and the miracle happens, the miracle solves the problem. You remember, Moses says, "Hein lo yaminu li, they won't believe me." God says, you want to persuade the Israelites that you're the guy? Take your staff and it'll turn into a snake and they'll believe you. And you know what? He took the staff, it turned into a snake, and they believed him. Moses says, but Pharaoh won't listen to me. Moses says, well, show him some signs, and if he doesn't believe the signs, I'll send a plague, and if he doesn't believe that, I'll send another plague and another plague. And by the time we get to plague three, lice! Already, the Egyptian magicians who can do most things, but not lice, definitely not on the curriculum of being a magician. And they say, Etzba Elokim, it's God's will. God does the miracle, and the result happens. The most famous of all, Elijah and the 400 prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel. Elijah says, let's have an open contest, prepare a sacrifice, see if God sends down fire or if Baal sends down fire, and we'll see. And the prophets of Baal try and they pray and nothing happens. And Elijah says, shout a bit louder. Maybe your God's asleep. Maybe there's trouble on the mobile phone and he hasn't got the message. Anyway, they try and try and try. Nothing happens. Elijah makes a prayer to God. Fire comes down and everyone says, Hashem hu Elokim. The last words we say on Ne'ilah, on Yom Kippur, Hashem hu Elokim. So the result is that you got a problem, you have a miracle and a problem, right? But it didn't happen here. It did not happen here. The truth is that the miracle didn't end the problem. And do you know why? Hang on. Do you know what did solve the problem? God says to Moses, take 12 sticks, one from each tribe. And just wait and see which one stops being a dead piece of wood and start sprouting leaves and blossoms and fruit. And Aaron's rod brings out leaves and flowers and shkedim and almonds, and everyone knows Aaron was chosen to be the priest. That ended the conflict. And only that ended the conflict. Why? Because the truth is that right at the beginning, Moses got it right. Right at the beginning, he realized that Korach and all his rebels were not rebelling against Moses. They were rebelling against Aaron. They knew Moses was the leader. Only he could speak to God. Only he could bring about miracles. Only he could send the plagues. Only he could divide the Red Sea. Nobody's going to challenge a guy with leadership credentials like that. But your number two, Aaron, well, we're as good as Aaron. And that's what they wanted. Their real challenge was against Aaron. And Moses knew this at the beginning, but now you're trying to get the priesthood too? You know, isn't it enough that you slapped the ark? Now you want to be Cohen Gadol as well? Who is Aaron that you should grumble against him? At the beginning, Moses knew the problem isn't Moses, but Aaron. The trouble is that the more they needle him and complain, he kind of forgets and starts thinking that they're attacking him. See what he says? This is how you will know that the Lord has sent me, that it was not my idea. God chose me, right? As the pressure mounts, he suddenly forgets the real issue, which is Aaron, and he starts taking it personally. If the miracle happens, this will prove I didn't make this up. I was chosen by God. He takes it personally. And at that moment, the conflict has been taken on by Moses, and Moses starts defending himself. And when that happens, you're in trouble. But the principle is never take it personally. That is the point. Do you remember what actually sealed Moses' fate much later? Do you remember? Moses struck the rock, and that was the sin for which he was not able to take the people into the land. What did he say? Moses said to them, listen, you rebels, must we bring you water from this rock? He personalized it. What? Must we bring him water? It wasn't about can Moses bring water, it's can God bring water. But he takes their challenge about the water personally, and he loses his cool and gets angry with him, and that seals his fate. He's not privileged to take the people out of the land. Never take it personally. And where did it begin? It began with Korach. When Moses, under great stress, facing this challenge, forgot that it wasn't about him at all. It was about the priesthood. When you take it personally, you lose your cool, you get angry, you start becoming defensive, aggressive, and then it becomes ad hominem, up close and personal. And when a leader takes it personally, he ceases to be a leader. Rule, very simple. Never take it personally. Shabbat Shalom.